So guys, if we are connected, I want to make sure I don't waste any more time. So thank you for coming online. Today, I'm going to be showing you a few pictures of this amazing place that I have been traveling to in the past 10 years now, 9 years to be precise. And this is a story of an animal which is very, very near and dear to me. It's the story of the mountain gorilla. And I want to just show you some of the pictures of this place, and I want you to know how this particular animal is coping through immense challenges and how it is battling its survival against all odds. So let's begin. I hope everybody's okay. So let me make sure everybody's okay. I'm sure now you can see me. There was a small lag in between. My streaming was telling me that there was a disconnection for a few seconds. Well, thank you. I'm now probably sure of going live. So guys, once in a while there could be a little bit of a streaming issue. That is because so many people are live, so bear with me if that happens. I think now it'll pause for a few seconds once in a while and we'll come back because too many people live and too many people online. I hope things go well. All right, so I want to begin this interesting talk with a movie that I adore a lot. And I also want to end it with one more movie by discussing about that movie as well. So I'm not sure how many of you are aware of this Leonardo DiCaprio starrer Blood Diamond movie. So I watched this movie a few years ago. I think this was made in 2005 or 6 or something like that. Blood Diamond is a very fascinating movie. If you're somebody who has been to Africa, who has seen the realities of Africa, it's very interesting to note how this continent is being plundered by mankind from hundreds of years, how people have been invading Africa like they did to India as well. But I feel Africa is still suffering, and until a few years ago, it was a very big battle there as well. So, Blood Diamond, if you've not watched it, I recommend you watch it. It's a movie about this small country in the west of Africa called Sierra Leone and how the European diamond market, which tries to mine diamonds from Africa, goes to this place, and there are these what do you call militants who are taking over this area, and that's how this particular story unfolds. The reason why I remembered this movie while I was putting together my presentation on gorillas, I see a lot of similarities between this movie, The Blood Diamond, which is actually a real story of what happened, to what is happening to the gorillas and the natural world of Africa, especially Central Africa. I do feel gorillas and other wildlife in Africa are also a different form of precious things in this world. They might not be diamonds, but they're nothing less precious as well. So please don't forget to watch this movie, Blood Diamond, if you have not watched. So talking about this area, which I want to focus on, it's called the Central Republic of Congo. It's a country which is Zaire, and also there are countries like Rwanda and Uganda, which forms this area in the center of Africa, where there are these amazing mountains called the Virunga Mountains. And I want to focus a little about this area because that's where you find one of the two species of gorillas in this world. The Virunga Mountains is a part of the eastern gorilla population, where there are about 8 volcanoes in this area, and out of 8, around 3 are active and the remaining are dormant. So it is called the Volcanoes National Park, especially in the area which comes into the Rwanda area. Rwanda is another small country. I'm sure some of you have heard of this small country as well. I want to remind you of what this country has been through not so long ago, just about 25, 30 years ago. I must remind all our young viewers, especially if you're in your teens and early 20s, you might not even know about what happened in Rwanda in the early 90s. The reason why I'm mentioning all this is it's directly related to the world we live in and the wildlife we all love to watch and enjoy and care for. So it so happened that in the mid-90s, 93, 94, there was a major clash between two groups in Rwanda, and that is what is called the famous genocide of Rwanda, where it seems around 800 1,000 people were slaughtered by rival gangs and groups and people who ran out of their country, including their president now, or our president recently. And it was such a massacre there that hundreds and hundreds of people died. This is a great photojournalist's picture that I'm showing you. It's a photograph of one such camp, which was formed in the borders of Tanzania, where they ran away from Rwanda because they wanted to save lives. Reminds me, when I was in Rwanda for the first time in 2011, I was actually driving towards the Volcanoes National Park, and my driver guide, Gaston, was explaining. He was probably 27, 28 back then, and he was explaining his experience, personal experience of the genocide. He was a few years old, he was a young boy, and when the attacks happened, he was telling me how on either sides of the streets, there were dead bodies, and it was such a bad scene. So he ran away to the forests and lived in the mountains in the forest for nearly 50, 60 days, he tells me. And this whole genocide lasted for 100 days. And if you go to Kigali, the capital of Rwanda, you can see a memorial built for this particular incident. It's called the Genocide Memorial. Now, the reason why I'm talking about all this is a country which has been through a lot, and they are home to perhaps one of the most important species of wild animals in this world. As a child, I remember how I was intrigued and I was fascinated by the gorilla. And I'm sure all of you also did when you watched King Kong and you saw how the gorilla was such a fascinating animal. Even though it can't speak and interact like the way we do, I'm sure in that movie we saw the emotions of this animal, which is perhaps not very different from that of human beings. So as a child, I was fascinated by gorillas. I'm just making sure all of us are connected. Things are going well. Very good number of people online. Thank you for being there. So let me take you through my journey of how I went and photographed gorillas and how I've been doing that. So I must tell you, there are a few groups of gorillas that live in these mountains called the Volcanoes National Parks. My experience is predominantly Rwanda area. I haven't been to Congo yet because I relatively feel Rwanda is safer and it's easier to do that, though it's quite expensive compared to even Uganda. Just to give you an idea, to do one gorilla trek, it used to cost $500 per person for 1 hour of a gorilla expedition, or rather experience, in 2011-12-13 era. Then I believe they increased it to $750, and I think in the recent times it's gone up to even $1,000. So it's an expensive affair. If you ask me why is it so expensive, that's because there are only a few hundred gorilla left in this world. It's not more of the cost of you going and seeing them. It's more of your contribution towards protecting this animal. That's how I look at it. I mean, even though $500, $700, $800,000 is quite a lot of money even for me, I feel when you go and watch gorillas by spending that kind of money, it's a contribution you're making to protect this very species. So let me briefly explain how a gorilla experience is usually and how it happens. All right. So any questions, you guys can keep asking. Once in a while, I'll pause from my talk and I'll go and have a look at all the questions you guys are asking, and I'll make sure I'll answer them. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you. So it so happens that you need to apply for a gorilla permit. Once you apply for a gorilla permit, you need to pay for it. Once you've paid and you've got your permit, you would be, for example, one of the 64 individuals on that particular morning who will go to see gorillas. Why 64? Let's say there are 8 different groups of gorillas, and each group of gorilla can accommodate only 8 tourists or guests or visitors, which means if you're planning to take a big group there, you shouldn't go beyond a group of 8 because you will be in 2 different groups in that case. So in my case, I take 8 people in a group, and I was also a part of groups where there are 7 others and I was alone, and 8 people form a group and they're assigned different gorillas. So just to let you know, gorillas are animals which nest every day. So they build a nest in the mountains and they sleep that night there. The next morning, very early in the morning, they get up, and the silverback, which is the leader or the main gorilla in the group, makes his way through to different areas, and the females and the babies follow and they go to a different place. So it so happens that at around 7 o'clock in the morning, we assemble at this reception. We are assigned different gorilla groups. For young people in a group, they assign a slightly tough trek. For elderly people, they assign a trek which is relatively easy, which means they should be able to find the gorilla in 40, 50 minutes, half an hour sometimes. Every day the gorilla locations change, so we cannot predict where the gorillas are going to be tomorrow when we book our permit. So it so happened that the rangers will see the individuals who are going on a trek and they'll assign a particular gorilla to them. So this picture you're seeing on the screen right now is one of the rangers briefing the small group of eight. I'm one of the group there. I've come out to take a picture while I'm listening to his instructions carefully. It so happens that we go to the edge of the forest and we start trekking into the forest through the fields, which are very close to the national park actually. What amazes me is to know how close the gorillas live from villages and people. On many occasions, I'm looking at a gorilla from a mountain top and I'm seeing a gorilla and I'm seeing there's a village down there. I can listen to people talking, walking in the fields, working, a motor on, some electrical sounds coming here and there. They are very close to people. Maybe 40 minutes of walk up the hill, you will find gorillas if you know exactly where they are. On that note, I must tell you, a gorilla trek is not easy. It could be a very tough climb up the mountain, especially these mountains. In fact, these forests are called the mountain forests. Why are they called mountain forests? Because they are at a particular altitude. It seems if a forest is about 2,500 meters or above, it's called the mountain forest. And gorillas live in this altitude. In fact, they're very close to volcanoes. That's why this area is called the Volcanoes National Park. Reminds me, wildlife viewing is a passion for many of us, right? So I remember perhaps one of the oldest people I have seen while I was in the gorilla trek so many years was this lady you see on the screen. I don't remember her name because I didn't imagine I'll be speaking about her in 2020 when I shot this photograph in 2011. But thankfully, I have a photograph of hers. She was 86 from England, wildlife enthusiast, traveled all the way to Rwanda. She has been to India many times. A lot of English people love India. And this particular lady was told many times by the gorilla rangers that it's going to be a tough ride up the mountain and she perhaps cannot make it. And she was insisting and she was very persistent and she started walking on the trek. Right now you still see we are walking through the eucalyptus plantations around the farmlands there. We are walking through the village and we are starting to get to this edge of the forest from where we start climbing up the mountains. It's important to know there are wild forest elephants here and usually we avoid the elephants because they can be very dangerous, especially when we are on foot because we don't have a safari car here. This particular lady made it to about 20 minutes of the climb. It was not an easy climb. She climbed very well for 20 minutes. After that, she couldn't walk at all. And we guys who had spent $500, the remaining six of us, she was the seventh one, I was the eighth one, were very frustrated that we were not able to complete this trek. And after 20 minutes of sitting and wondering and pondering over, those strong men you see there wearing blue, they are the porters. They're supposed to lift bags and help tourists climb these mountains. They decided not to leave her alone or take her down back. It was her life's goal to see the gorillas. So they decided to do something which I had not at all imagined. In fact, they carried her on their back for the rest of the trek. And as you can see in the next picture, just loading in a few seconds for you, she basically was carried by people all the way up to the gorillas. And I remember she was like a small 10-year-old girl when she went to the gorillas and she started jumping with joy there because she had seen an animal which she always wanted to. The reason why I'm telling you all these stories, guys, is watching gorillas is something which is a lifelong dream for many people. For a retired British woman who is in her 80s, $500 in today's era when she stopped earning 30 years ago is a lot of money. But that shows the passion she had. That shows what wildlifers are made of, what all they can do to see wild animals. So coming to the gorilla country, guys, thank you for listening to the introduction to the story so far. Gorillas live in these slopy mountains. There are a lot of vegetation here. There's a lot of vegetation here. In fact, you should know, gorillas are vegetarians. They are such muscular animals, but they are vegetarian. The silverback has biceps and chest and stuff like that, so big and strong, but they feed on leaves, bamboo, shoots. This is a typical habitat of how a gorilla can be seen on these slopy terrains when they're eating or feeding on bamboo. All right, fantastic. So once you reach the gorillas, you're able to get as close as 10 feet sometimes and 15 feet sometimes, some occasions a scary 5 feet when the gorilla is actually passing through an area where you are. And even though you don't go to the gorilla, sometimes they can come very close to you. I must remember in 2015 when we had a gorilla trek, I had a few clients and we went there. I remember all of us were so tired that it looked like we had to be brought down in a stretcher. In fact, it was so damn tiring that we had to rest before we see the gorillas. After the gorillas, we actually slept for 5 to 8 minutes to gather our energy. Tough trek, climbing up the mountains in slushy terrain, wearing gumboots, holding sticks and have everything. If it also rains during this time, it's even more fascinating and exciting to go there. But of course, once you reach the gorillas, you'll forget all the fatigue and tiredness and all of that, and you'll start enjoying them. I must tell you, once we reach the gorillas, the time starts ticking, and this is probably the fastest 1 hour of your life, because you have 1 hour to spend with the gorillas. The reason why they only allow us to spend 1 hour is because they don't want us to transmit any human related diseases to the gorillas, or in other words, capture or get infected by some diseases which are not there in human beings yet, but maybe there in gorillas. So we don't want to transmit diseases between each other, which is why I'm told they allow us to stay only for about an hour and not more than that. So once we start going around and we find the gorillas, by this time there is a group of trackers who are tracking the gorillas. We are going from the reception. At some stage we meet both of us meet. That's when we are with the gorillas. In fact, the trackers are always following the gorillas, and after an hour or two of trek, we meet the trackers about 100 meters away from the gorillas. There'll be one guy always watching the gorillas, while the others will be talking to our group with a radio, and they'll make sure we are all packed. We leave our bags in a safe place, because the babies should not come and handle our bags or pick up something and run away. There's one guy waiting for our bags while we take only small cameras and start walking closer to the gorillas. All right. Once we reach the gorillas, we should probably be seeing the head of the family, which is called the silverback. Why is he called the silverback? Because his back literally, pardon my tongue twister there, literally has gray hair on the back, and he's such a massive gorilla that human beings are tiny in front of him. This is a silverback you're seeing on my screen right now, and they can be 3.5 foot tall when they're standing on four legs, and if they stand on their back, on the hind legs, what we call as bipedalism by four-legged animals, the gorillas can be 6.5 foot tall. They can be taller than the most taller human being in this world, and they're very strong. They can probably wear 450 pounds, it seems, which is 200 plus kilos, and they, believe me, feed on vegetation. They are animals which live on shoots and bamboo and leaves and stuff like that, which is amazing to see. On this occasion, I was actually very scared. I was about 5-8 feet from the gorilla, and the gorilla's tracker understands his particular family very well. And on this occasion, he told us, please go down on your knees, don't stand up straight, don't elevate yourself above the gorilla, please bend and sit down. And we all sat down, and when the silverback came straight at us, and I'm taking this picture with a 24-70mm lens, he told, don't look into his eyes, because he's an egoistic fellow and he doesn't like to be stared at. So we all sat and saw down while I was holding my camera. It's okay to see through the camera, but if you see him through the naked eye, he feels you're taking on him, and he gets intimidated sometimes, not always. So he instructed us to don't see in the eyes of the silverback, and we saw it below. Trust me, I have been to all parts of this world, a lot of animals, but the encounter of seeing a gorilla on foot about 5-8 feet away with the silverback coming and standing in front of you and staring at you was such a scary thing. I promise you, this particular guy walked further ahead and went to the edge of the eight of us. We were eight of us lined up and sitting down like we were being punished. And he went to the last fellow and he put his arms on the last fellow's neck, and he just pushed the guy in to the ground and simply and walked away. And that was the scariest moment of my life till now, especially with a wild animal encounter. The ranger told me he was not really aggressive. It was his way of, when the rangers are interacting with the gorillas, do you know what kind of sounds they make? They keep making the sound so that they make the gorillas feel comfortable. They make sounds like, and this is the sound which makes the gorillas feel, it was very frightening to me being the eighth person on the other side. Going ahead, silverbacks are animals which form their own group, and they can be mating with multiple females of the group. I know that when I posted this picture online, a lot of people said he needs a dentist and stuff like that, because they have amazing teeth, they have canines, they can bite very hard. If a gorilla attacks you and bites you, I don't know what will happen. So this is a picture of an angry gorilla. He was not angry at the tourists, was just as angry as at some young gorilla baby in the group and who was being a nuisance to him. This happened in 2015 while this gorilla showed how his anger can look like, and I was so glad that I was there to capture it. All right, so I hope you guys are enjoying the storytelling session. If you have any tech issues, keep saying what you feel and what you go through. I will make sure I fix them as much as I can. Let me come back to this, continuing the story of the gorilla. I want you to know that when gorillas have babies, they're very protective of these babies. The females always cling on to, all the babies always cling on to the females, and they walk around and they move around with the babies piggybacking on them. Once it rains, there could be a lot of females which huddle up together, and the babies are protected and they're kept safe inside. And this is a scene of a tiny little gorilla baby which is being protected by adults, by elders. So talking about the feeding of these animals, you can see, as this photo suggests, this gorilla is actually picking up the shoot of this plant and feeding on it. It's an interesting behavior. They go and break the plant, they break the leaves, and they feed on these juicy stems of these plants. So this is a photograph of one such female gorilla that I photographed. And you can see in this case how he's breaking the bamboo and he's feeding on it. It's like a carrot for him. He's feeding on it here. Oh, actually, it's a her. This is also a female gorilla. And just making sure the streaming is going on okay, because I can see my streaming app being red and green once in a while. All right, so this is basically a female which is being which is feeding. Talking about mothers with babies, they are highly protective, as I said. On this occasion, this was the female of the gorilla which I was talking about, which was aggressive. And she basically was walking on the other way when I took this picture. It's also a 24-70 photograph. For people who have learned Lightroom from me would have seen a different version of this photograph that I use for you to post-process your images. This is an example of how I post-processed with the background getting highlights and the foreground getting dark. So this is a cute baby. While she's walking, the baby is actually looking at me and wondering what is this guy doing in our group. Sometimes the babies can be attacked by different individuals, so the mothers are very protective. The babies don't go away too far from the gorillas. In fact, I must tell you how it makes it possible for us to find these gorillas, because they are always on the move in the mountains, and for us to walk 100 meters is so tough. The gorillas are walking very fast because they're used to this terrain. On this occasion, we actually arrived at this place where a gorilla family was resting, which means it's the best time to catch this family, because you're walking, and when they stop, they're resting at around 9:30, 10 o'clock in the morning, because they have been walking since 6 a.m. and they all take a siesta. And you can see in this photograph how all the females are sleeping. The male was a little away and he was also sleeping. And while this little small gorilla baby is not sleeping, because as you know, babies are always active. When they want to sleep, they want to sleep. They can't time their sleep like adults can. These adults are sleeping so peacefully while this little baby here is actually playing around. And when I got very close to him, this was the same baby, and I had intimate moments of this baby while the adults were sleeping. Once in a while, the mom would lift her neck and see what the baby is doing. And when she saw me, she would get curious and see me. And when I'm just taking pictures and the baby is very busy playing with me, the mom goes back to sleep. And that was when I realized that it's such a beautiful acceptance by this family. They don't feel threatened at all because they've been seeing people, and I'm not doing any funny thing. Even though I'm with apes, I'm not monkeying around. Well, the babies are sometimes naughty. They're very naughty. They can actually go away from the family. If the family is on the move, the mothers make sure the babies are following the family. They're always with the mom. Otherwise, they can get lost very soon. Even though the mothers will find them, it's always better to not get lost, because remember, there are elephants, there are other animals in this park. There could be leopards, there could be other animals which can hunt and kill the babies as well. So it's important to be... Also, I must tell you, why I'm doing this storytelling session is because of something which is very, very related to the babies of gorillas themselves. The gorilla's baby is poached. They're not killed, is poached. They're kidnapped to be sold to, some Western countries where keeping such animals captive is not, not illegal. I'm sure some of you Netflix guys would have seen this amazing documentary called Tiger King, how it reveals a hard truth about tigers. that there are more captive tigers in zoos and in cages in America than the entire world where wild tigers live, especially in India and Southeast Asia and China and stuff like that. So it's so amazing how the rules of every country is different. We're so hypocritical sometimes. We make rules for the wildlife of our country, but if you bring a wild animal from a different country, it's not in the schedule of protection, so they don't care about it, which is such a shame. So babies are highly protected, and babies can be kidnapped by poachers. They might even do harmful things to the adults to take away babies from the families and sometimes sell them in illegal wildlife markets. And this time they're not even killing the animal. They might kill the adults for bushmeat and stuff like that, but in this case they will capture a baby in order to be sold to a zoo owner or a private animal collector or stuff like that, which is really a shame. It's like kidnapping a baby from its mother. It's such a big crime. I can't understand how some people can do that. Probably some buyers would not be able to relate to how they're getting these babies because they don't get into the root, which is what, guys, I like that movie called Blood Diamond. Even though it's a mainstream movie, we going to a jewelry store in Mumbai, Bangalore, Delhi will buy a diamond for our engagement or wedding. I will never realize where this diamond comes from. You only know it's been worked on in Surat, in Gujarat and stuff like that. But if you go to the depths of the story, you'll see how much bloodshed has happened for us to wear our wedding ring or engagement ring. Coming back to the gorillas, babies, very highly protected, and because of which we enjoy the whole scene. And in this occasion, you can see a picture of my group, which ended up doing the trek on one particular day. And this is a group photo of the eight of us. As you can see, there's eight of us. Some of them had traveled with me, and you can see how we are so dirty after the gorilla trek because it's a slushy place. It's completely wet because it rains sometimes. We wear raincoats, we wear lens coats, and we have a stick. And what's interesting about all the sticks that we are holding there, on the head of the stick, they would have carved a little gorilla face so that when you hold that stick, you can see a gorilla right in your palm. And it's such a sweet, beautiful experience. When I was in Rwanda from 2011, I went again in 13, in 14, 15, 17. I've not been there in 19. 19 was a hard year for me. 2020 has been a disaster. But talking about this particular place, guys, it actually is a lot of small villages around the Volcanoes National Park. And the people who live there, I must tell you, my heart melts when I see these kind of people who are so humble. They're so poor. They're struggling to meet ends, and they're still so passionate about their wild animals and their wildlife and the world they live in. There are a lot of young boys who go and enroll themselves as porters. There are a lot of young people who go and enroll themselves as rangers and forest guards. And I want to end the story in the next few minutes telling you something important. In fact, a lot of gorillas today are alive and are able to thrive because of these kind of forest rangers who protect these gorillas. I must tell you, these rangers use radios to communicate between multiple group of rangers, and they make sure no animal is in danger. Every group of gorilla is assigned with a set of trackers, and Rwanda is pretty safe. From the genocide in 94 to today, Rwanda has come a long way. They are pretty safe. In fact, it's probably, Kigali is considered to be one of the cleanest countries in Africa. But their history is really not very nice, especially in the mid-90s. But today, there are these young people who are protecting gorillas, becoming rangers. And I must tell you how wildlife tourism is such a major contributor to the protection of wildlife in many places. And Volcanoes National Park, Virunga area is no exception as well. Every dollar that we spend here is used to protect this area, and I'm told a large chunk of this money is going into the well-being of these small villages around these protected areas. Please trust me, if we don't take care of people who live on the periphery of these national parks and wildlife refuges, we cannot protect the animals. So this is a group of rangers who are always moving with the gorillas. They are always there to protect the gorillas from poachers or from any other dangers, also to take care of tourists and make them show their way to these animals. So I wanted to show you that this image you see, even though it's a gorilla trek, there's a gun, there's a ranger with a gun, there are multiple people of different stages, there's a guy with a radio, and they protect these animals very much. I think this particular Instagram session should be a tribute to these amazing rangers who are working. I want to end this story with a little bit of a back story to the story as well. This is a picture by a very popular photographer called Brent Stirton, and it was photographed, I think, in July of 2007. This is a scene after a gorilla family was massacred by poachers, or I don't know why they did this. They killed this gorilla family. They were militants. They killed this gorilla family. And this gorilla family is called Senkwekwe. Senkwekwe. And this particular silverback you see dead on the screen right now was such a huge guy that when people started coming in to carry him out of that place to bury him, they built a stretcher where nearly more than a dozen people had to carry this particular individual. When people see this image, they get shocked because this shows the proportion of the gorilla with the human being. They are so huge. This is a great silverback, and looking at his size, you'll realize what a great animal this is. And what a shame that this family was killed. About four or five gorillas were killed using firearms, and they had to bury these gorillas. And this is a powerful image. As wildlife photographers, as much as we love to photograph amazing stuff, pictures like these are ones which move the world as well. This is what is a storytelling conservation image, where apart from all the beautiful images we see, we also would be able to produce images which can change the mindset of people. When common man sees this image, he would definitely be forced to think about this. So this image made this area think about some rules and regulations, and it brought about change in the laws of the land, it seems. It's probably one of the areas which is the most dangerous places in the world for conservation people to work with, because it's not just, you know, in, let's say in Bandipur, or let's say in the fringes of Bandipur, there are cattle grazing, then, you know, you just need to talk to the villagers and make sure cattle is got back, or there are elephants raiding crops, you just need to talk to the villagers and make them not, you know, put electrical fences. And but here, guys, if you're a conservation person and you're going to help protect gorillas, you might just get fired, you might get killed. So it's a very dangerous area in the Central Republic of Congo and some parts of Rwanda and these areas. So hats off to all these rangers who are putting their life at risk and protecting the animals. I must remind you that not so long ago, in fact, not even a month ago, if not even a fortnight ago, on the 24th of April, about a dozen such rangers in the Central Republic of Congo were killed by militants. In fact, they were not necessarily the target of these militants, but it so happened that amongst many people who were killed, these militants killed at least 12 rangers who had put their life for the gorilla, and they were protecting these animals. So I really wish gorillas, who are now less than 700 individuals in this world, guys, it's probably more people in my building than all the gorillas in this world, which is such a shame, which is such a heart-touching story. I just wanted to share with you guys. I was going through a lot of these emotions. So just to put an end to this small little story here, I want you guys to think about what as we sitting far away can do to protect wild animals. It need not be all the way to go to Congo to protect gorillas, but we can do a lot of things. I keep getting a lot of people talk to me about, hey, what can we do here? Why should we talk about a wild animal somewhere there? But you must understand, the very diamond you buy from a popular jewelry store in Bombay, Bangalore, Delhi is directly related to the people who live in Africa, for example, who also might be getting these things from areas which are in conflict zones, and they must be struggling hard. In fact, even with wild animals, we might forget when we buy some small curios how they all come from areas which have a conflict, and how animals are getting slaughtered or poached, or even more so for that matter, the biggest threat for all these wild animals is not even poaching sometimes. It is just habitat loss. If you are somebody who has a lot of money, who wants to buy some land, and you want to buy land closer to a national park, you're actually thinking about ways in which you might be forcing cutting down that periphery there. So it's very interesting to understand how we can harm the world we live in, sometimes by even having, you know, as my friend Madhu says, even if you have a cup of tea, you're contributing to half a foot of land being used to produce that tea, which was probably otherwise a tiger's habitat. So think about all these animals apart from doing your interesting wildlife photography, guys. I think on that note, I want to make sure, if you are a Netflix user, you watch this beautiful wildlife documentary called Virunga. It's about this particular area in the Congo area, which is about the protectors of gorillas and how they're spending their life trying to protect the very animals that we love in. So that's pretty much what I wanted to show. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Guys, how was this story? I just hope you guys enjoyed watching this. I want to make sure I answer all the questions. We must do something to save these animals. Yes, by not harming them, we are saving them. So even if you can't do something good, at least don't do anything bad. All right, I'm sure there are 450 tigers somewhere. Well, how does that matter to gorillas? Well, guys, I think it's very tough to understand what we as people sitting far away can do. But one thing is for definitely sure, that we should look at this planet as one planet. It's not India, Africa, Rwanda, US and all of that. As wildlife lovers, you belong to this planet, not to Uttarakhand or Karnataka or to India or to something else, guys. So I want you all to think about not just learning about the oriental dwarf kingfisher which comes to the mangroves near, you know, your house, but to learn about this planet in general. Because what we do in traffic in Bangalore directly is proportionate to the polar ice, or to Antarctica, or to the penguins, or to polar bears, or to the gorillas, or to the tiger in Sundarbans and stuff like that. Anyway, guys, I hope this was a fun session. Oh, it lasted 40 minutes. I didn't realize I know so much about gorillas that I can talk for 40 minutes. Well, thank you for joining me. And I'm glad with this unstable connection here and there, we having small disconnections, we have been able to, complete my presentation. I am happy that all of you joined us. So thank you very much, guys.